teaching for a couple of months now on the power of prophetic declarations. Please, both those at the back, I will want you to pay attention. I want you to pay attention. Once again, thank you for turning out tonight. Thank you for your obedience, and I believe that your life will never remain the same. In the name of Jesus. Yes, before I go into the word, let's make some declarations. Hallelujah. Say with me, say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you and I worship you, because the season of my life has changed completely forever. Right now, I am in the season of great things and big things happen in my life with ease, in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth, pray in the spirit for a second or two. Say after me, say, in the name of Jesus, all those things that used to look big, all those things that used to look far away, everything that before now looked impossible, everything that before now looked impossible, right now in my life, they have become normal occurrences in the name of Jesus. I have entered into a dimension and a realm and a perpetual season where I enjoy unusual favor, strange dimensions of favor, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So we've been teaching on the power of prophetic declaration, looking at the power of the spoken word in the life of a believer, and we laid a very good foundation, and God was able to open to us why words are very, very powerful. And we saw about 7 reasons why words are powerful. And then we were able to now begin to lay a foundation to say, even though words are powerful, that there are times believers make declarations, they make confessions, they say things. There are times believers will command an angel to go into operation. It seems as if their words are ineffective. There are times a Christian will say to a demon, come out. And the demon will say, you too, come out. Praise the name of the Lord. I said, praise the name of the Lord. So, and we saw that the Bible said that there are certain words that are called idle words. And we saw it from the Amplified Bible, that when the Bible says the words are idle, it means they are non-functional, they are non-working, they are inoperative, they are words, they are just sounds, but they have a deficit of power, they are bereft of power, they are bereft of life, they are bereft of the substance that makes word what words are. Praise the name of the Lord. And so we took our text from Matthew chapter 12, verse 36. King James, please. He said, but I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. What we are trying to draw from this verse of scripture is that there is something known as idle words. So we are better able to identify them and understand what an idle word is from the Amplified version. So give it to us in the Amplified. Look at what he said. But I tell you, on the day of judgment, men or human beings will have to give account for every idle. Now, what is idle? He said inoperative, non-working, non-working. That means you can speak words and they are what? Non-working. People can speak words, even though words by their nature come to pass, even though words are creative, even though words activate spiritual laws, even though words activate spiritual realities and possibilities. It means that somebody can speak words that are inoperative. You speak the words, they don't go into operation. You speak a word, they are non-working. Because we're able to see from the Bible that the Bible says he sent his word and his word. I mean, he didn't go by himself. His word was a messenger of liberation. He sent his word. And his word went just the way a personality will go. His word became a personality. And his word went and healed where there was sickness. And his word went and delivered where there was bondage. Praise the name of the Lord. I said, praise the name of the Lord. Now, because his words were not inoperative, his words were not non-working. So basically, what we are looking at, how do I, as a Christian, make my words operative? How do I, as a young man, or as a young lady, or as a father, or as a mother, or as a businessman, or as somebody that has a car, how do I make my words operative? Is that clear tonight? So we said, and we are asking that question because words ought to be operative. Words, when spoken, ought to be powerful. The Bible says, where the word of a king is, there is what? Power. And what is power? Power is the ability to accomplish. Power is the ability to do work. Power is the ability to bring to pass. Are you learning anything thus far? Yes. So we said, the first thing you will do, if your words will be effective, if your words will carry power, if your words will produce results, listen to me. This is not just another teaching. These are principles of the kingdom. Is you must have a prayer life. Your prayer life must be updated. How many of you have tried to use a phone with a software that is not updated? You know, you struggle. So your prayer life must be updated. Your relationship with God must be fresh. You must have a constant, consistent prayer life. We saw that in the lives of the disciples. They stood with a guy possessed by demons in Mark chapter 9. Come out, come out, come out, come out, come out, come out. That also happened in the book of Acts, where the seven sons of Sceva tried to cast out a demon. And the demon just sat inside the person and was not going. And I think the demon was even eating roasted corn. Praise God. I said, praise God. Then Jesus was coming from a mountain where he had prayed and was transfigured. And when he got there, he said, what are you guys arguing here? The father of the child said that my son has a demon, a deaf and dumb spirit. And I have asked this, your disciple, to cast them out. And they've been here since morning. This is 6 o'clock. They've not been able to do it. The more they shout, come out, the demon will reply once in a while, I'm not coming. So, and Jesus said, come out. And the demon said, wow, I'm off. Packed his bag, bought ticket, and traveled. So when the disciples got back home in the evening, Jesus was eating boiled groundnuts, and they came to him. You say, how do you know? When you see him, ask him. He was eating dinner, just relaxing. Air was blowing him. And they came to him, and they said, Master, why? They said, and when he was coming to the house, his disciple asked him privately, why could not we cast him? Look at verse 29. And he said unto them, this kind can come forth by nothing but by what? But by prayer. By prayer supported by fasting. He said, you are not... Your prayerlessness in the life of a Christian has a lot of implications. Because if you go into communion with God, three things happen to you. Number one, you carry peace, the shalom of God, which means nothing missing, nothing. Number two, there is an impartation. Something is transferred to you. Something will leave God. Something that is God will leave God and come on you. Is somebody in church tonight? So that you will manifest the capacity of God. Hear me, please. A lot of the gap we see between what the Bible promises and what a Christian is on earth is a prayer gap. E.W. Kenyon said something. Kenneth Copeland also repeated it. He said, the Christian failure is a prayer failure. And that is why on Sundays, we are taking our time to teach prayer. Because a lot of Christians, they don't understand prayer. They don't understand the power of prayer. They don't understand the various expressions of prayer. Are we teaching tonight? And we're able to see from various scriptures that once people go into prayer, they become, something happens to them. They become filled and refilled with the Spirit. And the natural, Acts chapter 2 verse 4. So once the scripture comes, we will all read together and we won't comment on it. 1, 2, go, let's read. Please take note. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And the next thing is that they began to speak. Acts chapter 4 verse 8. Quickly. It's a Bible class. A lot of writing. A lot of notes taken. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said. Once there is a feeling, and a feeling comes from the background of prayer. Listen to me. How many of you have ever filled your, if you have a car, you filled your car with fuel. As you were using it, what happened to the fuel? Huh? And then after a while, your tank begins to show what? Red. Some Christians on their forehead in the realm of the spirit is red. Yeah, it's red. Christians can be empty. That's why anything can carry them. Any wind can carry them. Any depression flying in the air can land on them. They are empty. Anything can happen. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said. So after prayers, it's a feeling. After a feeling, it is what? A saying. Woo, glory be to God. Acts chapter 19 verse 6. And when Paul had laid hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them and they spake with tongues and what? Prophesied. Can you see now? Acts chapter 4 verse 31. Acts 4 31. And when they had prayed, the place was what? Just imagine the kind of prayer they were praying. You know the way some people pray? The Queen of England kind of prayer. Then they will reply, what's up? But look at what Bible said. Is it not the Bible? These guys are Nigerians. And when when they had prayed, the place was what? Shaking. Where they were assembled together. It was on a Saturday morning by 8 a.m. And they were all what? After prayer, what happens next? Feeling. After feeling, what comes next? Speaking. Powerful words. Words will not be powerful. They will not be operative. They will not be working. They will not be functional until it's coming from a life that is filled. Yeah. So listen to me. If you are here and your tank is red, you need to get what? You need to get what? You need to get what? Yeah. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word. They made bold declarations. People ask them, are you crazy? How can you say that all those things that are far away, they are now normal in my life? How can you say those things that used to look big, that used to look impossible, that they are now what? Normal. Tell them, say it's because I am filled. Hey. How can you say right now I am enjoying very strange dimensions of favor? Tell them, because it, I am what?
Filled.
I am filled. So we said, if your words are going to be powerful, you must have a robust prayer life. Number two, we said you must be a student of meditation. You must be a student of what? And that is because meditation fills you with the word of God. That is because meditation creates revelation. Meditation creates revelation. And when your words are from revelation, they are powerful. Revelation makes it personal to you. Revelation is the opening of the life and the light in the world into your spirit. So when you are speaking life. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
And we saw in Joshua chapter 1 verse 8 that this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. For then thou shalt observe to do according to all that is written therein. He said, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have what? Then we went from there to Psalm 1 that said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in the law doth he meditate day and night. He shall become like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaves also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth, including declaring, shall what? So we ask the big question, what is meditation? We say meditation is thinking and muttering. You think the word of God until you get to the point where you are whispering it to yourself. You are, listen, everybody look up. For anything to become permanent in your life, you must begin to say it to yourself. Some of you here, you talk to yourself. You know what you tell yourself? If your name is Abu, you will call yourself, you say Abu. But there are other things people call you, you don't answer. If your name is not Joseph, and you are walking on the road, and somebody said, Joseph, if you don't like Amebo, you will not turn. Because he no concern you. Is there anybody in church tonight? I'm asking, is anybody still in church tonight?
Yes, sir.
Are you understanding the word of God?
Yes, sir.
Meditation is when you have thought about a portion of scripture so much that it is no longer in the Bible. It is now you. Start to the point where it's not written for other people. This is you. That scripture has become flesh. The Bible says, and the word became what?
Flesh.
The Bible says, in the Lord doth he meditate day and night, and he shall be. And the Bible says, and the word became what? Flesh. They came to John the Baptist one time. They didn't know he had meditated in the book of Isaiah. They came to him. They said, who art thou? And what sayest thou of thyself? Every time I read that scripture, I'm sorry. I thought John would say, my name is John. B for Baptist. Zacharias. He didn't answer. He said, I am the voice of one. Some people that were at his naming ceremony said, but during your naming ceremony, they say his name shall be John. Why is he saying, I am the voice? It's meditation. That scripture entered his mind. It erased John from his mind. Entered his soul. Removed John. Removed family. That scripture now made him and turned him. He was actually living in the city. He had a two-bedroom flat in the city, in Jerusalem. By reason of meditation, he just found himself packing. Then he went to the wilderness. And by law, you don't get in life who you, what you want. You get in life who you are. And everybody in Jerusalem, everybody in Judah, they left the city, they trek, they bought tickets and went to the wilderness to meet him. See, I'm not teaching on meditation tonight, but it is meditation that makes men to become. And once you become, everything requisite that is compensatory to that dimension of life, they will live wherever they are. They will discomfort themselves and follow you. Governors will leave their office and tell cabinet meeting, wait, I am coming. They will go and look for you. Dollars will leave the oil companies, will leave US and look for you wherever you are. Once you enter that dimension, small deals, 5,000 naira deals, 250, they will be far from you. And 1 billion will be looking for you. 5 billion will be looking for you. You know why? That is your level. John left the city. He was not afraid. He went to the wilderness. They followed him. They came and asked him. They said, who are you? In your secret place, when you are muttering to yourself, what do you say about yourself? He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. He said, that's why all of you left your comfort and followed me to the wilderness. First Timothy 4:15. Meditate on these things. Give yourself wholly to them, that thy profiting, that thy advancement, that your progress might appear unto all. Ah! That's when he says, the entrance of thy word giveth light. He now said, the Gentiles shall come to your light. Kings to the brightness of thy. So we say kings, nations, they are on their way. They are coming to the brightness of my rising. Say great things. Say good things. Say blessings. Say material things. Pleasant surprises. Wherever they are, on the face of this earth, in the realm of the spirit, they are living where they are. They are flowing into my life. In the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Let's make progress. So number one, if you want your words to be powerful, what do?
Have a
robust or simply be prayerful. Number two, what is number two? Yes. Before I make progress on that, right? Once in a while, take a verse. Like yesterday, I saw one verse in the book of Proverbs. Paya. I was eating that verse between my house and the office. He said, the sluggard will not plow by reason of the cold. I was thinking. He said, a sluggard. Yes. He said, he will not plow. He won't walk. And he will give you an excuse and said, what's going on? Okay. By reason of the cold. And the Bible said he will now beg. Please help us. The Bible said he will beg in harvest. Glory be to God. So as I was meditating on that, it's cold. I don't know if you have ever seen snow, even in a movie. Is because we can't create an environment for lying in church now. Just say, if you have seen snow, raise your hand. Then they say, let's encourage the pastor. You raise your hand. Eh? When you have not gone from here to Kutonu, but you are going global. Yeah. See, listen to me. Going abroad is not hard. Don't do it as if it's a breakthrough. It's just another country. And a lizard in Nigeria is going to remain a lizard in London. Yes, a lizard in Nigeria cannot go to London and become an alligator. Mm-mm. Or become a crocodile. If you are a lizard in Nigeria, if you go to London, you will still be you just be a London lizard. And I can tell you that London lizard is suffering more than Nigerian lizard. Because in London, they don't throw bread on the floor anyhow. They trash it very well. So a London lizard is a hungry lizard. But in Nigeria, people just throw amala somewhere. The lizard will find something to eat. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let me not dwell on that scripture I was sharing with you, because cold is valid. The Bible says because of a valid reason, the sluggard will not plow. But there's no problem. But the Bible says there will come one day called harvest. He will begin to beg. Any area of your life you see yourself begging, is because when you ought to be plowing, you didn't plow. You beg for love, beg for money, beg for credit, beg for response, beg for attention, beg for job. Go and check somewhere. There's a deficit of plowing there. I'm too tired to read. No problem. Truly, you were tired. But there is something that is called rising above tiredness. I cannot save. My needs are too much. I cannot save. You are right. Your needs are too much. You will soon know that you are not El Shaddai. Any man that takes the place of El Shaddai shall die. I'm not El Shaddai. I can't solve everybody's financial problem. So your emergency cannot be my emergency. I said, he shall beg. Everywhere you see begging, go back, reverse, and check. You will see when they ought to plow, they didn't plow. This is just an accident. So let's go forward. So number one, have a robust. Number two, be a student of. Number three. Is somebody learning tonight?
Yes, sir.
Are you happy you came to church?
Yes, sir.
Shout aloud, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Your life will never remain the same.
Amen.
Number three. Believe your words will come to pass. When you open your mouth and you make declarations, believe that your word will come to pass. We have already established that words, by their nature, come to pass. But it is one thing to understand that words by their nature come to pass. It is another thing to believe that when you make a declaration, when you speak that your words, some people believe that when Pastor Abu make declaration, it comes to pass. And you are not wrong, because there's a grace upon my life that when I declare, they don't fall to the ground. It's the testimonies around that are too much. I was meditating on that grace recently, and I found out that it's not even church members that benefit the most. It's inside my house that will benefit. My wife being the major beneficiary, because she believes with all her spirit, soul, body, and destiny in that grace. I'm telling you. You can ask her personally, whether it's financially, you can ask her whether it's her career. We can shift it by prophecy. Now, but so many people don't believe that their words as a child of God, as a child of the kingdom, as somebody who has a robust prayer life, as somebody who is coming from a fountain of meditation, that what they say will come to pass. Mark chapter 11 from verse 20. So number three, believe that your words will come. You need to believe that when you bless your husband, the words will come to pass. You need to believe that when you bless yourself, your words will what? Are people still here? Believe that what is not what the witch said that will come to pass in your life. You are the principal prophet. You know, let's just jokingly say, there are minor prophets. There are major prophets. There are principal prophets. You are the combination of the major and the principal prophet over your life and over your destiny. You need to believe that what you say over your life is what we come to. I'm telling you. What you declare over your finances, what you declare over your life, that I will not die, my bones will not be broken, my blood will not be shed, I will not use my money to sponsor negativity, that is what will come to pass. Not what somebody woke up in the midnight and they say is a witch with a broken leg over you. No. Can I ask you what will come to pass in your life? What do you believe? What will come to pass in your life? Yes. A lot of people believe, they say, Pastor, pray for me, your word will come to pass. That is true. My words don't fall to the ground, they come to pass. I've seen my words change business. I've seen my word reduce cancer. I've seen it take out cancer. That is, cheaply. I've asked demons to pack and they packed and go. I've seen sicknesses healed. I've seen businesses. People have come and said they rejected visa. I said, go and put it back. They will give you. They put it back, they gave them. I've seen someone come to say, I have HIV, and I spoke and they were healed. Now, that is powerful. But you need to go beyond that. You need to believe that your own words will come to what? Pass. If you don't come to the point where you believe that when you rise in the morning and you bless your husband, it will come to pass. If you bless your daughter, bless your son, and if you, above all, bless yourself, it will come to pass. There will be a gap in your life. Nobody loves you more than you love yourself. Nobody has more passion for you than for yourself. Nobody carries the grace to bless you like the grace upon your life. Is somebody in church? Let's take a small journey, case study. And in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up. From where? From the roots. Every negative thing in your life, in the name of Jesus, because you are here present, seated, online and on site, I command them to dry from their roots. Amen. That amen is a weak one. Amen. That amen is a weak one. Amen. Whether it is manifesting as poverty, manifesting as delay, manifesting as sickness, manifesting as suffering, manifesting as stagnancy, manifesting as a restriction, manifesting as a limit, in the name of Jesus, they dry from the roots. They dry from the roots. In the name of Jesus. Verse 21. And Peter, calling to remembrance, said unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is what? Withered away. Verse 22. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. Now, in the original, what this is reading, he said, have the God kind of faith. Have the kind of faith that God has, which means God believes and does what? Speaks. Verse 23. He now explained to them, because in their heart they were asking that what is the God kind of faith. When you say have faith in God, or the type of God's faith, what do you mean? Then Jesus began to explain to them. Please, let's read together. If you are alive and well, you are a Christian, you are here. Have you been blessed so far?
Yes, sir.
Have you been blessed so far?
Yes, sir.
Let's read together. One, two, go. Oh my God. Help me highlight the last part. He shall have whatsoever he says. Let's say it one more time together, every one of us. One more time. For the last time, very loud. Now let's change it. I shall have whatsoever I say. Let's say it together. One, two, go. One more time. Louder. Powerful. Your life will never remain the same.
Amen.
By reason of these, what your effort cannot bring into your life, they will appear in your life.
Amen.
What others are killing themselves over will be easy in your life.
Amen.
You will not need to spend money, but it will appear in your life.
Amen.
This is Jesus that said it. I, looking at myself, looking at my body, who my father is does not matter. Who my mother is was not taken into account. Whether I'm a graduate or not was not taken into account. What I have gone through, rising and falling, nearly succeeding and not succeeding, was not taken into account. But we came to a place where there is an assurance. He said to me, I shall what? Have. What? Eh? Eh? What so? What? Eh?
Whatsoever
I say. Aya, this is too powerful. This is too powerful. Say, in the name of Jesus, I enjoy, I experience very strange dimensions of favor wherever I go, wherever I enter. Whatsoever I do, men, women, systems, institutions, structures, they favor me. Now, how do I get to the point that I will have whatsoever I say? Talk about a good husband, a good wife, a baby, a job. The job, not just any job, the job of my dreams. A piece of land, a house, a dimension of the anointing. Open doors, healing, health, liberation. How do I get to that point when whatsoever I have said will manifest? Number one, he said, whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea. That means there must be a command of faith Then it now begins to come to where the matter is. After giving the command of faith, he said, and so it means a lot of people have spoken, but they didn't move to and shall not doubt. In his heart, his mouth has said something, but his heart is against his mouth. Parikatush. Give me something. Let's see how that happens. Matthew chapter 15, verse 8. Draweth nigh unto me with their mouths and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is what? The battle is inside your heart, and what changes your heart is the word. That is why meditation must come first. Listen to me. There's no way you are a student of meditation that your heart will not cooperate with your mouth. A lot of people say things. They say in church, I am wise, I am rich, I am free. And their heart will just be laughing. I say, Kai. Huh? Say, Omomu no do. Praise God. Yes, that's what their heart is. They say, I rise, I keep rising. Their heart will look at them from inside. Say, Omomu no do. Listen to me. You must not allow. Let me show you the meaning of the word doubt. Let me see. Just wait first. Let me. Just give me a few minutes. It's a Bible class. And shall not doubt. The word doubt in the Greek, in which it was written originally. Take us back to. Whoa, our time is fast spent. Take us back to Mark 11. Is the word diakrino, D-I-A-K-R-I-N-O. It means to separate because of a hostile spirit. Do you understand that? The first meaning of doubt in the Greek, how it's described, it means to separate because of. Do you know, have you ever been talking to somebody? Please just come, let's demonstrate something quickly. To separate because of a hostile spirit, it means maybe we are talking and he's just say anything. Good morning. Just say that's doubt. Your mouth says, I rise, I keep rising. Then the heart says, abba. Leave me alone. That's doubt. To separate because of a hostile spirit. Diakrino. That's the Greek word. Diakrino. To separate because of a hostile spirit. Thank you, sir. It means to oppose. It means to strive with. It means to contend. It means to dispute. It means to be at variance with oneself. Is somebody in church tonight?
Yes,
I said, is somebody in church tonight?
Yes,
it means to be at variance with yourself. How can you be at variance with yourself? One part of you say, I go forward. Another part holds you back. He said, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he buyeth, but shall believe
or she has worked for. He said, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. But shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. Listen to me. The Bible says he shall have whatsoever he saith. That means I will never have whatsoever I have said until I come to that point where with everything inside me, I believe that what I have said will come to pass. Hear me. Every faith will be challenged. Every faith will be tried. Every faith will be tested. Without a test, there can never be a triumph. Let nobody deceive you. The Christian walk has points of contention where your faith, where your declaration will be contended against, where it will be challenged. No wonder the Bible says that the trial of your faith, that the trial, that means, have you ever seen them trying somebody in courts? Your faith will be brought under trial. Your words will be tested. But he said, no matter how much you try my declaration, I believe that those things which I have said shall come to pass. How do I cleanse my heart of doubt? The word, meditation. For faith cometh by hearing. For faith cometh by. A lot of Christians have memorized it, but they don't do it. 12 midnight yesterday, I was talking with a pastor on phone, and I said to him, at every point you catch me hearing something. Whether I'm in the car, I mean, we're driving my children this morning to school. Most of the time we gist and I give them brief lectures on life. But for this morning, we're just listening to Hagin. And I could see everybody was concentrating. We're all listening to Hagin. At every point, you catch me hearing something. At every point, you catch me hearing something. In the midnight, Bible is playing. Early in the morning, worship is playing. Something you catch me hear. You can't afford for your tank to be red. Can't afford it. Especially in the generation that we are now. It's a very distracting generation. Listen, let me say something. Everything you watch on social media is programming you for something. Everything you hear, there are certain things. Sometimes some people don't know why they are sad. It's what you watched. You have watched too many sad things. Go to CNN. Every news there is bad news. Go to Sky. It's bad news. It's something. Something wrong. Something bad. Nothing positive. They will say the economy is going down. 10 million have died of hunger. And then when you sleep, a voice will say, will you also die? There's nothing wrong with the news. There are news for financial analysis. There are news you need for to be able to dimension the external environment. But let me say something. If you sit and keep eating, because everything you are seeing, everything you are hearing is feeding. I was in the office today. They said, I heard people talking. So they said, didn't you hear? I said, you hear what? They said, somebody was lying on the floor praying. God, come and help me. God, come and help me. Something.
I said, honestly, I'm on break from social media. That was, some people wanted to arrest somebody. They were breaking roof. I said, I'm not aware. They said, I said, no. They were arguing. I left to go and listen to a motivational teaching on my tape as I was working. And all, it's none of my business. It's none of my business. It's all drama. It's all Nollywood. It's all comedy. Nah them. It's none of your business. Some of you, your blood pressure has gone up. Ah, it's my brother. She's my sister. It's not your brother. It's not your sister. You are on your own. Build your faith. I'm not preaching against anybody. I'm just encouraging you. Just encouraging you. For 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 13, as I begin to come to a close. Next week, I'm going to talk about walking the revelation of the sacrifice. Tell your neighbor, say, stand by your sacrifice. A generation that is full of knowledge. Satan is in trouble. Help me shout, say, stand by your sacrifice. An altar must take his power from a sacrifice. You don't know my sacrifice. The King of Kings. The Lord of Lords, the Lamb of God, and I stand by my sacrifice. Telling you, oh, Pastor Abu, we have buried a goat against you. Bury a heart. I stand. We have killed a dog. We cut the head. We cut the leg. In the midnight, we shook the blood. Then we declared against you. Don't worry. Continue. I stand where? Mangareka patakatayaya. Somebody has cursed you. Somebody has declared over you. I don't care. They bury tortoise. I don't care. They bury lion. I don't care. Where do I stand? And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Then by the word, I stand where? Goliath was coming for war. He had sacrificed to the Philistine gods. When he came, he stood by his sacrifice and cursed David. David said, you don't understand. You are an uncircumcised Philistine. That means blood was not shed for you. I come from the background of a higher blood. Ah! Tell your neighbor, you say, I stand by my sacrifice. Say, Jesus is my sacrifice. I break through by the blood of the Lamb. Shout hallelujah. There was a day I was teaching, so I said, your prosperity will be blood sponsored. Somebody say, hey, hey, hey. When you have watched Nollywood, it has panel beat all your brain. Eh? It has pummeled. Let's use the word pummel. It has pummeled everything inside you. You interpret everything. What you just say? You just see yourself by your DSTV. That's what you see. Oh, precious is the Jesus. have a praise to praise. Some of you, you have a prayer to pray. Somebody has a declaration to declare. Somebody has something to say into the atmosphere. Don't keep quiet. Take advantage of the atmosphere. Take advantage of the anointing. If you want to live where you are standing, you want to live where you are sitting, please leave there. Make sure you are praying. Make sure you are praying. I gave you 2 minutes. That devil is a liar.
All around your life. In the name of Jesus, make progress. In the name of Jesus, go forward. In the name of Jesus, enlarge. Be healed in your spirit. Be healed in your soul. Be healed in your mind. Be healed in your will. Be healed in your emotion. Be healed in your body. Every blood condition, be healed now. Epilepsy, go now. Backache, waist ache, in the name of Jesus, go now. Migraine, go now. Every womb, carry your baby now. I command the door of supernatural and miracle jobs and contracts be open now. In our midst will die. Every business multiply now. Enjoy supernatural patronage. Supernatural patronage. Supernatural patronage. Your life is preserved. Your destiny preserved. Your health preserved. Your children preserved. In the name of Jesus. Financial miracles in your life. Financial miracles in your life. Financial miracles in your life. Financial open doors. You will not be ashamed. You will not be stranded. In the name of Jesus, I plant your feet in new grounds. Thank you, Father. We give you praise. We give you honor. Jesus, we worship you. May your name be glorified. May your name be glorified. Let's celebrate the Lord as we package our offerings.
Hallelujah. Let's celebrate God with our offering this evening. Hallelujah. Give something unusual to God this evening. I hear the sound of what? Of abundance of rain. Hallelujah. So give an offering, give a seed that will provoke that harvest, that will provoke that outpouring of the Spirit of God, of financial breakthrough upon your life. Hallelujah. So be intentional about your giving, because something is about to break loose, something is about to hit your account, something is about to hit your financial life. Hallelujah. If you believe that, shout a big amen. Somebody say, I hear the sound of abundance of rain. Miracle money coming in our direction in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you this evening, Lord. We give this offering as a token of what you are about to do, of the outpouring that is about to happen in our life, of the money that is about to hit our bank account, of the financial progress, financial breakthrough that is coming our way. Father, we give you praise, Lord. We step into that promotion. We step into that level of financial giving and into that level of receiving much more in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, blessed Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Cast your offering as you listen to the following announcement. Hallelujah. Our service days are Sundays, 2 services on Sunday, 1st service by 8:30, 2nd service by 10 a.m. every Sunday. But this Sunday is peculiar, is unique. What are we having this Sunday? I can't hear you. What are we having this Sunday? And what's the theme? What's the theme? The creative power of words. Hallelujah. And know that it's a single service. Tell your neighbor it's a single service. Make sure you come early to church by 8:30 a.m. It's a single service. God is going to do us good in Jesus' mighty name. Okay, the final rehearsal for the Children's Day celebration, for all parents, please be reminded that the final rehearsal is this Saturday, the 28th of May, after prayers. Please be reminded. And also the dress code for Sunday, that's for the children. The dress code is for the boys is blue or green t-shirt, and for the girls is pink or red t-shirt on a blue jean. Hallelujah. So please invite your friends, invite your neighbor. Come with a family to church, not just one person or two person. Come with the whole family in your compound. If it's to rent Costa Bus, go and rent Costa Bus. Hallelujah. And bring them to church. Glory to God. So workers interview is also taking place this Saturday after prayer. Workers interview for all those who have picked the form to join the service area, to join the theme, please. Your interview is coming up this Saturday. And if you've not done so, you still have an opportunity today to pick a form from the media deck so that you can be a partaker of the interview coming up this Saturday, the 28th of May, after prayer. Hallelujah. June praise and miracle service. Hallelujah. Somebody said the sound of victory. Glory to God. All right, so after the children's celebration, the next Sunday, which is the 5th of June, is our praise and miracle service for the month of June. All right, and the theme is the sound of victory. Please indicate if you want to give your testimony, see any of the pastors so that we can put your name down for testimonies. All leaders should please wait behind after today's service for a brief meeting with the pastor. All leaders, please wait behind after service this evening for a brief meeting with pastor. And please let's be reminded to establish at least one person in church before the close of the year. At least one person, invite them and establish them in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible said, they that be planted in the house of God. Hey. Oh. Hey. Oh. bless you, my brother. Thank you for coming. A card has been given to you. Please feel it. We'll meet with you shortly after the service. Have you been blessed? If you've been blessed, rise up to your feet as we take our declaration. Glory to God. 1, 2, 3, go. God has made all grace and earthly favor abound towards us. Therefore, we have all sufficiency in all things and except for every good work. All kinds of miracles happen in our midst with ease. There are no limits and no limitations in our life. There are that family that achieve great things with great ease. For the Lord our God in the midst of us is mighty. God bless you.